I welcome all of you to a great poem and its explanation. The poem is titled The Cold Within. It was written by an Irish American poet, James Patrick Keane. It was written in the 1960s during the Afro-American Civil Rights Movement. Keane was outraged by inhuman discriminatory attitudes at the time and wrote this poem to prompt some serious soul searching. The poem consists of 8 stanzas. So let us start with the first stanza and its explanation. 6 humans trapped by happenstance in bleak and bitter cold. Each one possessed a stick of wood, or so the story is told. This story starts with a tale of 6 persons caught together in the grip of a severe winter. Each of them probably had a single stick of wood. Please note that in this context, wood represents the person's abilities and resources. The poet uses the word humans. I repeat the stanza once again so that you remember the stanza and the explanation that follows. 6 humans trapped by happenstance in bleak and bitter cold, each one possessed a stick of wood, or so the story is told. So the poet uses the word humans so that he can draw our attention to the gathering as specific individuals rather than as a collective group. And they were trapped by happenstance, implying no escape from a situation created by chance. The adjectives dark and bitter, describing the cold, added to the ominous feeling. So, my dear listeners, please understand, 6 humans trapped by happenstance, so it was a chance, by chance, they came together to a spot and they have to survive there. It was cold and the cold was dark and bitter. And each one had a stick of wood, and wood here represents the person's abilities and resources. So that was the introductory stanza. Now let us move on to the second stanza. Their dying fire in need of logs, the first man held his back, for of the faces round the fire, he noticed one was black. So in this stanza, a key character is introduced, that is the dying fire. And here the fire represents the common good. The group's prospects do not look good. As per the stanza, the group's prospects do not look good because the fire was dying. In the heart of the winter, as we know pretty well, keeping warm is critical to survive. The fire offers a chance for salvation if each person would use their respective logs to feed it. So, my dear listeners, the dying fire was a silent appeal to the group to help themselves by helping each other. To help themselves, they can help themselves. How? By helping each other, by feeding the fire with the log of wood with the stick of wood that each one of them carried. However, we find in this stanza that the first person withheld his log from the fire only because it would benefit a black person. So in this stanza, the author is talking about racism, where there is discrimination because of a person's skin color. So the man will not even warm himself if someone he looks down upon just because of his skin color will gain. So what a tragedy. The first stanza was introductory, taking us into the situation, into the context. And in the second stanza, the poet talks about racism that was demonstrated by one out of the six humans. Then, let us move on to the third stanza. The next man, looking across the way, saw one knot of his church and could not bring himself to give the fire his stick of birch. Amazing. I repeat this stanza. The next man, looking across the way, saw one knot of his church and could not bring himself to give the fire his stick of birch. So what does it mean? The second person looked across the fire and saw someone who he knew did not share his religious ideology. And just because of that, he can't bear to give up his log to the communal fire. He was not willing to give the stick of wood for the benefit of everyone. And this is bigotry, which speaks of intolerance to a person just because the other person does not share the same opinions or ideas. So what a pathetic situation. What an evil attitude, isn't it? What a level of intolerance that one of the six humans has demonstrated. So I repeat, in the first stanza, we were introduced to the happenstance, and in the second stanza, we talked about racism. In the third stanza, it's about bigotry. Then moving further, the fourth stanza is like this. The third one sat in tattered clothes. He gave his coat a hitch. Why should his log be put to use to warm the idle rich? I repeat, the third one sat in tattered clothes. He gave his coat a hitch. Why should his log be put to use to warm the idle rich? Now here the focus shifts. Here is a person who was in tattered clothes. That means he seems poor. His tattered, old and torn clothes in the cold weather hint at poverty. He perhaps felt the cold more than the others, as we notice that he gave his coat a hitch. What does it mean? Adjusting it closer to his body to wring out some warmth from the inadequate clothing. That means the man was poor and he was sitting near the fire, but he too was not willing to give his stick of wood to the dying fire. So we see that he is a victim of classism. And what is classism? Discrimination based on social or economic class. What is classism? Discrimination based on social or economic class. Considering those favorably placed than him to be idle. So he thought the rich are idle. They don't do anything. They just have wealth. So why should I give my stick for the benefit of the idle rich. That was the argument of, that was the attitude of this man. So he is defensive, and in his eyes, the rich do not deserve his meager ration, and he will not part with his stick. So, my dear friends, in the first stanza, we were introduced to the context. In the second stanza, we talked about racism. In the third stanza, we talked about bigotry. And in the fourth stanza, we talked about classism. Now, let us move on to the fifth one. The rich man just sat back and thought of the wealth he had in store and how to keep what he had earned from the lazy, shiftless poor. So this was the argument. This was the argument going on in the mind of the rich man. So at cross purposes, we find the next exhibit of apathy of the rich man. Caught up hoarding his riches in his head, he is oblivious to reality. Greed has blinded him, and he selfishly connives to keep his wealth. He even miserly holds on to his stick, keeping it from the poor, whom he perceives as aimless and lazy. Actually, the rich man was victimized by the poor man. Poor man was not willing to give the stick because of the presence of the rich man in that gathering. Now the rich man also demonstrates his apathy for the poor man. So, introduction, then racism, then bigotry, then classism, and in the fifth stanza we talked about the apathy that was demonstrated. Now in the sixth stanza, the poet says, "The black man's face bespoke revenge as the fire passed from his sight. For all he saw in his stick of wood was a chance to spite the white." So look at this. This stanza talks about revenge that the black man wanted to take. The same black man who was victimized in the previous stanza, now he is also victimizing the white man. He is also demonstrating the revengeful attitude. That means even the victim becomes an abuser here. We know the black person had experienced racism. In the second stanza, we talked about that. Now, revenge for the atrocities he had faced from the white people was the only thing that was going on in his mind. What a pathetic situation, isn't it? All could have put their sticks in the dying fire and they could have survived. Then, one wonders if he had already resigned himself to dying, because he saw the fire pass from his sight. He realized that the fire was fast getting spent. The fire was almost dying. So it seems to us, when we ponder on this stanza, maybe the black man was almost surrendering himself to death just because he wanted to take the revenge on the white man. It seems that the spark of human kindness had died in him, and literally too, he chose to let the group's fire die. So he would perish, but he would take the others he hated down with him as well. So we come across such people in the society also. They die, they get destroyed, and they take others also along with them. Then let us move on to the seventh stanza. In the seventh stanza, the poet says, "The last man of this forlorn group did not accept for gain. Giving only to those who gave was how he played the game." I repeat, The last man of this forlorn group means hopeless group, the group that has given up all hope. The last man of this forlorn group did not accept for gain. Giving only to those who gave was how he played the game. So for the first time in the poem, titled The Cold Within, the poet foreshadows the fate of the group by finally describing the bunch as the hopeless, forlorn group. Until then, the poet had reserved judgment, allowing the listeners of this poem just to examine each individual in turn and derive his or her own conclusions. So this attitude of this last man in the story refers to a look shared between people, where each hopes that the other will do something that all of them want, but none are willing to initiate. So here the poet talks about inertia, not doing anything attitude, coupled with commercial attitude of the last man. Now let us talk about the last stanza, the 8th one. Here the poet says, their locks held tight in death's still hands was proof of human sin. They did not die from the cold without, they died from the cold within. What a tragedy is this. We witness the grim aftermath of the group's rigidity of spirit. Death comes, and it is personified here with stilled hands. Each individual became their own agent of death. What a tragedy. Their hands frozen stiff with their refusal to act. The fact that each of them still possessed their firewood when they died suggests the twisted motives in retaining their firewood, and it was enough proof of sin. The final lines of the poet abound with irony, because they did not die from the cold without, they died from the cold within. We realize it was not the cold weather outside that has really killed the group. After all, it was the cold in their hearts, the lack of warm human spirits, the cold within, that has killed all of them. So this message, my dear listeners, my dear friends, is relevant even today when we face divisive outlooks in the world that lead to hatred and violence. So may the Almighty God give us proper understanding. May the Almighty God help us in rectifying our attitudes, enhancing our character, and developing our personalities. Thank you very much. Thank you for your patience, and thanks for listening.